Okay, so bug triage. Any ideas here? I'm sort of triaging some of them as they come in, and then neglecting most of the ones that we already have. And I'm not getting a whole lot of help with that. Maybe we need to do a better job of getting getting new contributors into the kernel team. Maybe we need to a better way of sharing responsibility for the bugs that are there, like tagging them. I don't know, but as it is, we're doing a really bad job. So, anyone, any ideas? Please take a mic from here. Someone must have ideas. Oh, come on.
So it seems either we need more people or we just need to be more strict about closing vague and unhelpful or single system bugs or, you know, much more, I mean, picky about what we keep.
Yeah.
Which is surely going to piss off some users. But
they're pissed off enough already.
Well, yeah, it's not like, yeah, it's not like they're happy as it is. So, yeah. I mean, almost auto closing with a template message type thing. I know some teams have report bug templates that get showed saying there's no point reporting a bug against our team. Essentially, take it upstream first, please. And things like that.
Right. Well, for us, that kind of works for unstable. I mean, it could work if we said, yeah, take it up upstream, because unstable is normally going to be very close to upstream, close enough that. For stable, that's no good, though. And then there's the question of, well, where do you go? Where do you go upstream? Which is not terribly well documented. Maybe we should do a better job of documenting that and having a template for a template response to say to direct users upstream, whether that's in the report bug script or something that we send as a manually as a response.
Right.
Just fill in the blanks.
Yeah. I mean, maybe auto-closing things that have been more info for N, no response. I don't know if the BTS has that kind of metadata.
Yes, possibly, with probably not quite automatically, because sometimes we forget to take off the more info tag.
Right.
But yes, I think anything that is it really is more info, no response for several months should be closed.
I'm not sure about how old are the bugs. If a bug, for example, is for a kernel that was in Debian Lenny or something like this, it probably the best way to do to treat with deal with it would be to ask, does it still exist? And if not, close. I bet there might be many
Yeah.
very old bugs in it.
Yeah,
I'm not sure.
we have had a few people used to do that. I think Dan Fraser and TBM used to go through the old bug, but I think anyone's been doing that for a while. When we had the package renamed from Linux 2.6 to Linux, most bugs that were filed against Linux 2.6 got a ping or a closed saying, please reopen if it really still applies.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. For old, you know, old stable and older, I think close assuming it's fixed, and then they can reopen.
Yeah.
Rather than maybe for newer stuff, you might want to ping, but.
Is it worth having a like something like a bug squashing party, looking at kernel bugs only, and then you know, sharing the sharing the hard questions.
Yeah, I think so. Coming up with template mails and things, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Martin asked me if we wanted to do a maybe summit, bug squashing at the Linux Hotel. We could do that.
Mm. Martin
Zobel.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We want.
So that's a few ideas. Any more? Or should we move on to the next?
I think we might already do this. Do we have our own set of mappings to priorities? Because most users would think that anything that calls their computer not to
there
boot
is something
brave.
In the that went into the handbook.
Yeah. Maybe just making sure we all know about that and apply it more aggressively. Maybe include it in the report blog template if it's not.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's fair to make that more obvious.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay.
Sorry.
Actually, maybe an idea would be to there's this what is it helper tag that you can put to
yes.
bugs. So maybe if you think, well, I don't have the time right now to figure it out, but maybe it doesn't really need a lot of kernel knowledge to actually figure it out, or actually just try to reproduce. So sort of request for reproduction sort of tags, where if it just has simple instructions of how you got there, just ask other people to try and reproduce.
So this is the newcomer tag. Is that the newcomer tag? Is
yeah,
that
I think so, something
called?
Like that.
Yeah. There are probably some that we could use that for. I suspect not that many, unfortunately, but
course, because then you would have fixed it yourself, right?
All right then, so kernel flavors. We spent quite a while cutting down the kernel flavors so that we get pretty fast build on most architectures. MIPS has been very slow, but Aurelian just deleted several flavors there, so those won't, that won't be too bad. And for AMB64, PPC64, YL, ARMHF, ARM64, they're fast enough that yeah, maybe we could add different flavors if there's if there's demand, if there are good reasons for adding different configurations. So one interesting thing I've been hearing about is the idea of using KVM to make KVM with minimal VM as a stronger form of containerization, and Intel showed something called Clear Containers, and there's now something called LKVM, which you can use for that. should we be shipping a tiny kernel that would enable something like that?
Do they not also rely on reworking the user space boot process and things to be optimized?
Probably.
Probably. That doesn't mean it's not worth having such a kernel. But
And some people have been asking, I think someone asked about RT for the RT feature set on ArmHF. Can't remember who, that hasn't happened yet. I never have much of an idea how many people are using RT on Debian, a real-time patch set.
Me neither.
Any other ideas? You know, anyone really feel that the current flavors aren't suiting their needs? They need a custom configuration or patch set. Don't say GL security because they don't want to work with distro. They don't want to combine GL security with distro patches. So, not going to happen. Probably. Everyone's happy with the standard kernel packages. Really?
It's a little bit large, but it works.
Yeah. That's what I kind of hoped. Okay.
We could also start to split the large build into more than one packet. Maybe. To remove the parts that are not often used.
Mm. Yeah, I noticed that I think Ubuntu has a split between the most common and less common drivers, those, the latter being optional. Not sure quite how that works or how they decide.
What I found with Ubuntu, I don't know whether it's really necessary to do it this way, but they have a special server kernel, I think. Mm-hmm. In an extra package. I don't know whether it's really sufficient differentiation between this one and the other one. One probably would have to look at the configuration of each of these to see what they change.
I think the difference is they turn preempt off on there. Okay. But there may be other differences.
One thing I was wondering is with as we move to D-dubs and all that stuff, would it be possible to kill the kernel package, because the debug package, because that's a huge package.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's turn into a D-dub.
It is part of the spec that we can create our own D-dub and replace the current debug package with it. And then we should be able to build it for all for all flavors, all architectures, without overflowing and other mirrors. And as far as I know, the deck patch actually landed some days ago. So we could, so it may work in a short time frame.
It is going to make builds slower. Compressing that debug package is probably the single longest step of an AMD 64 build.
Yeah, it is, and it is.
But it doesn't.
It's not really concurrent.
Right. Building separate packages, building separate binary devs is parallelized, I think, but the compressing the debug packages takes so long that they end up being the last things running.
Some suggestions for splitting out are the media drivers, which take a rather lot of space, and
which are the media drivers,
for example, DVB drivers.
Sorry, I'm still not
DVB.
Oh,
for looking TV.
Digital video broadcast.
Yes.
It's not used very often, and not by many people, and so maybe those who need it can install it.
And
also stacking is also a lot of space, takes also a lot of space. So stacking drivers could also be an extra package. Maybe some people don't.
We already do this splitting out into lots of tiny packages for the installer, and it's kind of a pain. I'd rather have fewer little packages.
I don't think we really want to cope with more than maybe three, maybe even only two.
Maybe stacking is a good thing to leave it out of the default, because some people don't like stacking drivers.
We have to check which part of the driver tree really uses the space. Then we can decide which one you could split out without producing a lot of outcry by people.
The biggest driver directory is net, about 26 megs, media 16 megs, staging 14 megs, SCSI 11 megs.
It does seem GPU 8 megs. While it'd be nice to split them up, it's one of those sort of infinite manual bike shedding kind of tasks. Yeah. And if you move something out, someone will complain, and then you have to have a whole argument about it and repeat without very clear objective criteria, I suppose, which is hard to do.
Yeah, I think we can take the example of the UDEB there when we have split in very, very small UDEBs, all the drivers, and for example, the NIC driver, the names, the extra, the one in extra are kind of the usual from now, and the one in the main are kind of the one from 10 years ago. So
20 years ago in some cases.
Yeah, maybe 20 years ago. So splitting splitting is possibility, but we should update that regularly, and we have to do that. I'm not sure we will continue to have someone looking at that regularly.
Mm. With the UDEVs, what I'd actually like to do is firstly, teach kernel wedge to pick all modules under a particular directory. Yeah, that haven't been included in some other UDEB. Secondly, I'd like to actually look at the DI image configurations and which groups of module packages are always placed together, and then combine those, because there's no point having them separate if they're always used together. Anyway, that's completely off this topic. Any more thoughts about kernel flavors? No? So, testing. There are several a growing number of self-test programs included in the upstream source. I've started work on getting those to run under auto package test. And that's done. So auto package test has several different ways of running tests. The default, I think, is to use a container, and that's what ci.debian.net uses at the moment. But you can ask to run in a QEMU VM, and that's what I'm doing for the kernel. The idea is to pull in the Linux image packages, and then boot each kernel using kexec, and then run the build and run the self tests. So I have that working in as far as the self tests run, but a lot of them are failing. And that could be due to something silly like we haven't turned on the necessary features in the kernel configuration. But I don't think that's it. I've fixed a number of those cases. So this implies that upstream isn't actually running those, or at least they're not paying much attention. And if they're not, then it's probably not that useful to run these ourselves, because we're just going to detect that upstream broke it and not that we did something wrong at the packaging layer. And then if ci.debian.net becomes able to run things in a VM, this then prevents the kernel from ever transitioning to testing. So maybe it's possible to go through these and fix all of them. I probably won't have time to do that. But I'll probably spend a little bit more time getting these, seeing if there's anything easy, and then I'll push those changes, and then maybe someone would like to look at the test failures or not. There are other test suites that are out of tree that would also be good to run to look for regressions. I don't know how we would include those, whether they would need to be included in the source package or whether they would be packaged separately. And then, because auto package tests allows you to specify extra effectively build dependencies, but for tests. So we could package these test suites and pull them in for the tests. Anyone interested in working on that? Anyone got ideas for test suites that would be good to run?
Hey, does this work?
Yeah. It might be worth to look into OpenQA by OpenSUSE.
Right.
They can do quite a lot of stuff. They can even run stuff in a VM. They can take screenshots. So. If you want to check the graphical installer, for example, you can also use that. It's quite feature-rich. They even
right,
use that, it for
there are people working on the installer, but I just want to be able to test the kernel. More or less in isolation, although I suppose there are some things that we're... I mean, so what does is this OpenQA meant to test the full system, or is it for testing the? Is this for testing individual packages, or is it for testing the whole system?
As far as I understood, it's mainly targeting testing the full system.
Mm-hmm.
So. They also use it for Android, for example, or for the Fedora stuff also. I haven't looked much into it yet.
Okay. That probably isn't suitable for auto package test, although it's definitely something we should have. We should have that sort of thing in Debian. Probably going to be something that they install, which should be part of the installer tests. Install the system, try these things, do they still work? So, Holger was working on that at one time, and I think Kibi is now. So talk to them if that's something that you want to work on. So anything for package tests of the Linux package and checking for regressions. There's someone back there. Do they have a microphone? Someone pass the microphone.
Hello? Hello. When we upgraded, for example, for the ARM architecture, when we do an upgrade from WSI to JESSE, few platforms broke or couldn't boot.
Mm-hmm.
There were a few problems. I'm aware upstream now they have a site called kernelci.org, and they're running Lava, and they're running upstream kernels checking bootability. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's something we can also try to integrate and test our ARM kernels with, or they already have a machine farm. So we just writing the tests there so we can test Debian kernels boot on some of the devices. That
so, Lava sounds good. But this is an entirely separate framework, right? Maybe the thing to do then is to be able to run the auto package test.
But you really
suite
want to test bootability
in Lava. So we test. Oh, but I don't know. That may be something entirely separate because that's all about testing the hardware initializers, right? That we have all the right drivers and drive tree and so on. Yes.
Yeah, it's a smoke test that machine boots. Was fine, or you can. I mean, you can write your own tests if you want to do something especially.
Yeah, that's probably something separate from the auto package test. But I know Neil Williams has been working on Lava. I know he was talking about testing Debian kernel packages on Lava. Is that in place?
That's not in place, but we also discussed about setting a Lava service for Debian, but mm-hmm. we found that there was like a small corridor discussion.
Okay.
We just discussing over lunch. But it seems like it's going to be a lot of maintenance overhead for setting
right.
up all these services, because you need to maintain the server, but you also need to maintain a lot of little devices and plus run the tests and keep track of the results. So see, if somebody already have the farm, they're already maintaining this, why not use their resources and have few tests running or kernels? It might make more sense. I don't know, maybe we can do the effort and try to set up the service if people think it's interesting, but it's probably gonna give us more work of maintenance.
All right then. So we now have packages, all the packaging files in Git, which is quite convenient, solves a few problems. We still have only the Debian directory in there, which is kind of weird given that upstream is Git as well. But on the other hand, we don't simply well, first of all, there are a lot of different tools for working on Debian packages in Git and managing your patches. We have quite a lot of patches, some of which have to be applied to the upstream source before building a ridge.tar.exe. And sometimes we have feature set patches, and they're only applied for some of the builds rather than for all of the builds. So I don't know which, if any, of the existing Debian package in Git tools would work with those. I haven't had had time to actually try any of them yet, though I may do. Does anyone want to advocate for any particular tool? Or anyone have negative experiences with one of these tools and managing a large patch series? Vagrant? Are you?
It's a much smaller patch set, but I've basically it's a much smaller patch set, but for U-Boot, we just apply patches, or I basically merge the upstream versions and then apply, you know, and then rebase. Well, no, I don't rebase it, but I just apply the patches and as a merge commit.
So in your Debian.tar.exe, is it just a single patch for all Debian specific changes?
No, we just merge them in. There aren't a separate series of patches. I just merge them into the upstream branch because we're producing a DFSG style upstream.
And that includes the Debian changes.
Yeah. But I mean, it keeps track of the new upstream version. I merge it, and then that Debian dir corresponds to that new upstream version. But it's a manual workflow. But I imagine you have to rebase the patches using whatever patch system you've got now. Here you'd have the advantages of Git to.
Sure, yeah.
I've got Git DPM.
Mm-hmm.
It works with the patched source. You can just have an upstream branch that's patched. But
an upstream branch that's patched?
Yeah. Why not?
So
okay, it's the name of the branch, not it doesn't tell you what in which condition it is in.
So it's patched with what?
With the DFSG patches.
Okay, yeah.
I've got one package where I need that actually, but it won't support the feature sets.
Right.
Because you only have one one source.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing I would say about Git DPM is it's not that great if there's multiple maintainers working on the tree at the same time, because the way it merges rebases into things, the unpicking if you're the one who loses the race is quite
it's annoying. It's a bit inconvenient because it uses a little bit unusual merges.
Yeah.
It merges the patched tree into the Debian tree, and the latter only contains Debian patches as directory, but not the patches itself.
Sorry, say that again?
The tree in the end includes Debian patches,
mm-hmm.
and it and the so the never mind.
I think that's going to be a common problem with anything for doing patch queue stuff in Git, mm-hmm. that's relying on clever merging rather than a quilt-like series file or mm-hmm. something. I think they're pretty much all going to have some sort of potential for rebase nightmare.
I've got no experience with anything on the scale of the kernel or DFSG patches, but Git build package makes you easy to switch between patched and unpatched. Okay, so Git build package makes it easy to switch between patched and unpatched mm-hmm. sources with its patch queue management. And if it is Git, it should cope with a large patch queue, I guess.
How much help do you get with merging or rebasing onto a new upstream version in Git build package?
It has a support for invoking standard Git rebase for the patch queue branch on upstream imports or over upstream imports. I don't know whether it can be used for rebasing with respect to the upstream Git commits. It does it with respect to the upstream merge commit. So I mean a single commit.
Anyone have experience with Git Dev Cherry, is that it? Or there are others. Dgit. Anyone think Dgit is good for maintainers, regular maintainers?
Isn't Dgit the stuff where you can see the archive as Git?
I think it's kind of orthogonal. It's more like dput and sbuild and that sort of thing, I think. Although it does let you keep your Git history in a more Git-ish form and expose that to people. Don't think it would solve our problem.
No. Okay. Python 3, Bastian.
I don't have problems with Python 3, but Wheezy, which is still supported, only has 3.2. And that's a little bit inconvenient.
Yeah, but no one's doing backports from Sid to Wheezy.
Yeah. Otherwise, it should work, mostly.
What's wrong with 3.2? What would be the problem with 3.2?
There are some things missing between 2.7 and 3.2. Stuff like argparse and other stuff that is used. And with 3.3 and newer, you can even build tools that work with both 2.7 and 3. You can't with 3.2.
Okay. And you are, so I take it you are actually backporting from Sid to Wheezy and some.
I know that it doesn't work. 3.2.
You know what doesn't work? You know that Python 3.2 doesn't work. But is that a concern?
No.
Okay. Let's do it then. Yeah. Those are all the topics I came up with. Anyone else? got some issue with the kernel maintenance that we should discuss now. Don't want it back? Where is that? No? One. Yeah, well, it looks like we're out of time and topics. So, got that exactly right. Thank you all for coming.